Channel open. Welcome back to Weekly Trek, a proud member of the Tricorder Transmissions podcast network and presented in partnership with TrekCore.com. I am your host, Alex Perry.
What's today's date? The date.
Today's show was recorded on December 11th, 2020, and is current through the Star Trek Discovery episode Terra Firma Part 1, so beware of spoilers. All right, let's get into the show.
Good day, Voyager, and welcome to A Briefing with Neelix. It's a catchy title, isn't it?
Weekly Trek is a 30-minute news show covering the biggest stories from the Star Trek franchise. We are in a new golden age of Star Trek. There are 6 television shows in production, possibly more on the way, and enough merchandise to fill the Bajoran wormhole. So stick with me and I'll help you sort the real facts from a lot of the Dominion propaganda that you'll find online. But I can't do this alone. And my guest this week is returning guest and host of Warped, the completely unnecessary Star Trek podcast. It's Matt McClendon. Matt, welcome back to Weekly Trek.
Thank you very much, Alex. I'm really happy to be back.
All right, Matt. Well, you know the drill. I want to know something that's got you feeling good about Star Trek at the moment. What's got you moving at Warp 10?
Okay, so here we go. I had a hard time thinking about this. At first, I was going to plug my own Christmas tree, which you have seen pictures of on
Twitter. An incredible Christmas tree of nerdery and fabulousness.
Super nerdy. I live in a multi-faith household. The other person who lives in this house is a Star Wars person. So our tree is by nerdish. I don't know what the right word is. We've got a lot of Star Wars stuff and a lot of other nerdy stuff up there, but a lot of Star Trek
Hallmark
stuff
has multiple licenses, right?
Yeah, there's no shortage of ways for Hallmark to make you spend hundreds of dollars on Christmas ornaments. But the thing that occurred to me when I was thinking about it today was Marina Sirtis's Twitter feed. I can't imagine that people who are listening to this podcast don't already follow her on Twitter, but if you don't, you really should. She's so funny and she's kind of takes no shit from people. And she kind of claps back when people come at her for things. And I just find her a completely delightful Twitter follow. I don't follow a ton of Star Trek people. I follow a few, cast members. I follow a lot of Star Trek fans, but I don't follow all of the people who are from the shows on Twitter. But I do follow her, and I think it's because she always kind of makes me laugh. And a few days ago, somebody was harassing her for being irrelevant, and she posted a picture of herself with a giant mock-up of the stamp of her face that they're right. That they're putting out in England. And I just think she's really funny. So I would suggest everybody follow Marina Sirtis on Twitter if you're not already.
Yes, talk about somebody who has no filter in any environment that she finds herself in, whether it's online, at conventions, on talk shows. Marina is a delight. And yeah, if she has an opinion, she does not hesitate to share it with you, I think is the safest way to put it.
She posts a lot about football, British football, which I don't follow. But, you know, other than that, I think she's great.
Yeah, she is pretty awesome. Yeah, in terms of fun Star Trek Twitter follows, she's pretty high up on the list, certainly from the celebrity community. There's some celebrities who are much less fun on Twitter. We won't name them, but, you know, one of them was the star of a 1966 version of Star Trek, but that's beside the point.
I had to block him eventually. I just couldn't take it anymore. And I love him. You know, he's iconic to me, but I had enough. And I was like, you know what? I don't need to know this.
Right.
I don't need to know this about you.
Yeah, for me, it's less his politics, which I find a little, but it's more his fighting with like 12-year-old girls. Like,
yeah,
can we not draw a line in that, picking every Twitter battle you possibly can because someone said something that annoyed you?
I feel like he needs doesn't he have a million horses? Why isn't he out? Why isn't he out doing horsey stuff? Why is he spending all of this time on Twitter? He needs a hobby.
I mean, apparently he has time for both.
I guess so.
Well, the thing I'm feeling good about Star Trek this week is there is a little bit of evidence flying around on the internet that Star Trek Strange New Worlds is now in pre-production. The rumor, of course, being, I think we've talked about this on a previous episode, that Strange New Worlds will start filming in February. But there has been a picture going around of a cast and crew sign for Star Trek Strange New Worlds that was posted outside of the filming location, the production facility where we are expecting filming to get started early next year. And that is very exciting. Something similar happened for season 4 of Discovery, and season 4 of Discovery started up. So this is not the kind of thing that's sort of totally confirmed news. I'm sure when it is confirmed news, we'll share it, but it's always nice to see something like that starting up. There's also been, if you follow the deepest, darkest corners of Star Trek Twitter, you'll also find there have been some potential character breakdowns that have been floating around as part of this audition process for casting for Strange New Worlds. And so there will obviously be more actors on the show beyond the, you know, Kirk, Spock, and Number One. We won't talk about any of that until it's more official. But yeah, I think there are some exciting signs about that show moving ahead. And I'm very much looking forward to that because we're obviously closing in on the end of Discovery Season 3. And it's potentially going to be quite a while before we have live action Star Trek again. But I think once it comes back, it's in for the long haul.
Yeah, it seems like it's going to be a lot. You know, it's going to be pretty consistently one show ends and another show starts. It seems like the way they're probably going to do it, which makes perfect sense. I saw the picture of the cast and crew sign. Where are they doing it? Is it in Canada?
Yeah, it's at the new CBS studio in Toronto.
Uh-huh.
So they, Discovery is done at Pinewood in Toronto, which CBS rents a big piece of for Discovery, but they sort of maxed out their rental space at Pinewood, so they went out and built their own facility, and that is where Strange New Worlds is going to be filmed. It's actually not, they're not sort of co-located with each other. I think they're like 20-30 minutes away from each other, but yeah, CBS now has their own studio up in Toronto.
Well, it's just another thing for the haters to get upset about. I mean, you know, they've got to be serious if they built their own studio.
Yep.
You know, they're not just renting some building somewhere. If they built their own place, they're doing it.
And they're installing one of those Mandalorian style virtual walls to do digital environments too.
Mm-hmm. Which looks great. I quite enjoy the Mandalorian.
All right. Well, with that, let's turn to the week's top stories.
There's a war going on, and I'm a reporter.
Evan Evagora, who plays Elnor on Star Trek Picard, gave an interview in late November with the Pod Syndicate and confirmed previous comments by Jonathan Frakes about the expected date for filming to begin on the delayed second season of Star Trek Picard. Yeah, January we will be filming, he said. I don't know if they have posted the date. All I know is everyone's saying January, 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 so we'll start season two there, and in my opinion, it cannot come quicker. I'm so excited, not just to get back to work, but to get back to the Motley crew and hang out with everyone in California. A January start date for production for Picard season two would be exciting, given that the original plan was for the show to begin filming in June of this year before the COVID-19 pandemic made that impossible. Of course, that could all still change. The US and California are experiencing high case rates for COVID-19, and though productions have resumed filming in the Los Angeles area, it is not certain that will continue with the virus continuing to rage in the short term. In addition to talking about the production for Picard season two, when asked what other legacy Star Trek characters Evan might want to see return in season two of Picard, he mentioned a desire to see appearances by Geordi. LeVar Burton has mentioned he is in talks about a Picard season two appearance, and an opportunity for Elnor to spar with Worf. Matt, well, you're in the Los Angeles area, so you're my correspondent on the ground for this one. What do you think? Is it realistic that filming for Picard season two might begin in January?
I mean, I haven't left my house in 9 months, so I have limited information outside of the four walls of this apartment building. But yeah, I mean, production has definitely started up on things. You know, people are working, and I would like to see LeVar Burton on Star Trek Picard. I would also like to see LeVar Burton host Jeopardy. Is that a thing you guys have you guys talked about this on this show?
We haven't, but I would love that too. I mean, he's talked about it at conventions for, I mean, he was talking about, I remember a decade ago at a convention, he was saying, you know, one day Alex Trebek obviously will retire, and when he does, I think I might want to do it. So this is something he's had his heart set on for a while, and I think he should do it.
I think he is perfect for it. Between Star Trek and Reading Rainbow, I think he has this whole generation of now adults, but kids who kind of grew up with him as a sort of avatar of like learning and knowledge and science. And he just seems like the perfect guy to me.
You know, it clearly needs to be somebody who's got like nerd cred, right?
LeVar Burton would be great. It would be great to have a person of color do it. he's perfect for it. If they choose anybody else, it's a mistake. Back to Picard. It's crazy to me that they haven't confirmed Michael Dorn, because he's been talking about wanting to play Worf again for 20 years now. Like, he's been advocating for the return of Worf for a long time. So it seems crazy to me that they won't bring him back. Gates McFadden has openly talked on Twitter about wanting to come back. I feel like we're going to get everybody at some point, you know? At some point or another, we're going to get everybody who's available and willing to do it. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if they bring back Denise Crosby. And, you know, maybe Sela is still alive in the future somewhere. It's the show's about Romulans. Why shouldn't she be? Mm-hmm. They didn't talk about what happened to her in season one, did they?
Nope. They
did I forget something?
Uh-uh.
Okay. So she could do it. I think we'll get to see everybody. I was talking to a friend of mine recently who is, he did not love season one of Picard. And I said, well, didn't you love the episode where he went and saw Troy and Riker? Wasn't that a great episode? And he did not like it. And he called it fan service. He's a bit of a curmudgeon, if I'm being totally honest. And I said, well, yeah, I guess it's fan service, but I'm a fan and I like being serviced. Like, what's wrong with that? I wanted to see Riker and Troy, and there they were, my old friends again. So I'm all in for bringing everybody back who is available and wants to do it. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, I think space it out, you know, give them something good to do in the episode. Like Dorn, for example, he was approached about doing a cameo in the premiere of Discovery as like another Worf ancestor. And he said no, because there wasn't enough to do in the role and they weren't willing to pay him the dump truck of money that he otherwise was requesting.
Well, that's fair. I mean, you're right about that. If they have something good to do, it can't just be here they are, right? You know, I don't want to see, God bless her, but I don't want to see Grace Lee Whitney watching the ship come in Star Trek 3 or whatever. I want to see, give them something good to do, give them a part to play.
Yeah, and that was sort of like, you know, when people were the doctor from the Stargazer in one of those early episodes who comes and tells Picard that, you know, he's been diagnosed with this disease, and lots of people were like, well, why isn't that Dr. Crusher? And I'm sort of like, did you really want like that scene to be the scene in which you get this great character to come back? Shouldn't this be an actual, you know, shouldn't there be a whole episode around this person rather than it just being a, you know, one-off in and out?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That would have been a complete waste of her to have her be just in that one scene. It would raise more questions than it answered if it had been her in that scene, because you'd immediately want to know, well, what's she been up to for the last 30 right. years, you know?
What's their relationship status?
What do they like these days, you know? Or yeah. So, but I'm all in favor of Elnor getting to talk to anybody Elnor wants to talk to. I think Elnor is great.
Well, after a several year break, Creation Entertainment is bringing back its regional Star Trek conventions in 2021. Now called the Sci-Fi Summit and expected to include actors from more franchises than just Star Trek, but with a strong Star Trek focus, Creation will be holding three conventions next year outside of Las Vegas. The three conventions will be held in Vancouver, Canada on July 16th to 18th, Edison, New Jersey on September 10th to 12th, and in Jacksonville, Florida, also on that same September 10th to 12th weekend. William Shatner will be the headliner for all three conventions, and other confirmed guests include a number of stars from Star Trek Discovery, Star Trek Picard, Deep Space Nine, and The Next Generation, with additional guest announcements expected as we get closer to the events. Well, Matt, isn't it exciting to think about the possibility of returning to doing conventions and seeing people other than ourselves in 2021 as we all hopefully are about to get vaccinated against COVID-19?
I am excited to think about the idea of leaving my house, you know.
Right.
That, to go to the down the street would be exciting at this point. But yeah, of course, we had planned to go, the gang from the podcast that I host, were planning on going to Las Vegas this year. That obviously didn't happen. So it's rescheduled for, I guess, August next year is when it's supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. I'm very much looking forward to that. I have not been to a convention since I was a kid. I was probably like 12 years old, I think, the last time I went to one. And I've just recently, in the last 3 years or so since we started doing this podcast, gotten sort of re-engaged with the fandom. I was always a fan, but I was not engaged in sort of the community. And now I am again. So I'm very much looking forward to going to Las Vegas in August. And for you guys who are on the East Coast, it must be thrilling to think I can go to New Jersey. You know, that's a, what is it? 3 hours by car?
Yeah, not even, probably about 2.5. Yeah.
Yeah. You can get there really easily. So that must be, I mean, for you guys, it must be amazing to not have to fly all the way across the country to go to a big convention.
Yeah, Creation used to do a convention in New, it sort of bounced around New Jersey. Sometimes it was in North New Jersey, sometimes it was in South Jersey. And I did go one year, and it was pretty great not to have to get on a plane and fly all the way out to Las Vegas. They also used to do them in Boston and San Francisco and Chicago. I'm hoping this ends up being successful and they sort of bring it back, because it's nice to have, you know, more things to do over the course of the year than just Las Vegas. And it's actually sort of interesting. Obviously, we talked about this on the show when we talked about how Las Vegas was canceled for December. Actually, I think it was this weekend that it was supposed to be happening, and it was moved to next August. And as part of that, we found out that Creation Entertainment had lost its license to be the official Star Trek convention. But this sort of sci-fi summit idea of having other franchises, this is actually something Creation used to do way back when. They had this thing called the Grand Slam, and it took place in Pasadena, actually, and every year. And it was a sort of big kind of multi-franchise convention that they did. And then they got the official Star Trek license, and they sort of moved towards doing more of the straight Star Trek conventions. But, you know, it could be interesting to have actors from other franchises as well. It is nice, though, that it'll sort of keep that kind of main sort of Star Trek focus. That'll be, you know, that'll be a lot of fun.
Do you suppose there will, that riots will break out between the Orville people and the Star Trek people?
I mean, to the extent that the Orville is just a lame copy of Star Trek. I'm kidding.
Oh,
I'm kidding.
You're going to get emails. You're going to get nasty tweets. Be careful what you say.
I'll put it this way. I am thrilled that the people who love it, love it.
Sure. Everyone should love what they love.
Well, after test launching the project last year in the United Kingdom, Eagle Moss and Hero Collector have officially unveiled and begun taking subscriptions in both the US and the UK for their Build the Enterprise D project. This partwork subscription will see you receive 4 shipments of pieces of the Enterprise each month to allow you to assemble your very own model of the Enterprise D that is over 2 feet long. In addition to being quite a sizable model, it is also fully lit and has the ability to separate the saucer and star drive section. The model is a hybrid of the 3 Enterprise D models that appeared throughout the run of the show, neither of which were exactly the same as either of the others. The original 6-foot model, which premiered in Encounter Farpoint, the 4-foot model that was introduced in season 4, and the 2-foot model, which was used at various points during the production. Eagle Moss have improved significantly upon the design presented for the test ship in 2019, which includes painted windows around the rim of the nacelles and correcting some of the proportions of the model slightly. But this will be no small investment of time or cash. The complete collection will run to 120 issues. That's nearly about 2 years worth of collecting. And it will cost you about $12.90 per issue, shipping at a rate of 4 per month. That's about $40 for about 2 years. You could do the math. It's actually quite a lot of money. So in addition to the model pieces, each issue has an accompanying magazine with features and behind the scenes info about the Enterprise and the Next Generation. Subscribers also receive several free gifts, including a display base for the model. Well, if building a gigantic, fully lit model of the Enterprise D is on your agenda for 2021 and 2022, head on over to the Hero Collector website to sign up. Matt, do you have room for a over 2 feet long model of the Enterprise D that you build yourself?
I mean, you've seen my Christmas tree, but the short answer is no, I do not. Is it the biggest model like this that they've put out? Is there a, have there been bigger ones than this that you know of?
I think it's the biggest commercially available one. Yeah. I know that, like, the sort of, you know, round 2 AMT Urkel models, I think the biggest one they put out was like 18 inches long, and this one's like 27.
I had 2 thoughts about this when I read this article. One was, I think it looks amazing. I mean, it's absolutely beautiful. Well, I guess I had 3 thoughts. One is, it looks amazing. 2 is, it takes a long time to get the whole thing. It's 30 months. It's 2.5 years before you put the final, I wonder what the last piece will be. that you get.
Yeah, right.
It'll be some tiny little bit that you stick on.
It'll be an escape pod from like the, you know, the star drive section.
And my third thought was, my gosh, it's expensive. It's with shipping and everything, it's got to be like $2,000.
Yeah, it's like $1,800 for the whole collection,
which is, you know, if people can afford it and that's what they like, then I'll more power to you. I don't have any objection to that. But I was like, boy, that's a long time to wait. Even if you're getting one piece a week, that seems like a long time to wait. It may just be that I'm an instant gratification kind of person, and I don't really like having to wait for things. So I don't know that I think it would drive me crazy waiting 2.5 years to get all of the pieces for this thing. What about you? Does it appeal to you? You're more of a collector than I am.
I am, and I do not think I will be getting this one. And it's not necessarily the price associated with it. I mean, I've seen people saying, you know, well, $1,800 for a model like that, you know, that's the most expensive model you'll ever buy. And of course, there's a little bit of truth to that. But in addition to, you know, that just being the sort of aggregated price of the model as well, I mean, you are sort of paying for the experience and the excitement of sort of building it over time and seeing it come together. I mean, it's not just the model that they don't ship it to you all at once and that's your $1,800 model. So, you know, there is sort of a paying for the experience piece of it too. I just don't know that I have anywhere to put something that large. I'll also be honest, you know, a Partworks subscription like that, I have been burned before on Partworks where you sign up and then they get halfway through and then they cancel it because they don't have enough subscriptions. And then,
oh, I didn't even think about that, but you're absolutely right.
You don't end up with a complete thing, right? Which for something like a figurine collection, like the Eagle Moss busts that they put out, they commissioned an initial run of 10 or 12 and then not enough people bought them, so they just sort of ended it at 12. And like, you know, it's Kirk, Spock and McCoy and Picard and Data and Worf and Janeway and Sisko and Burnham and Saru and Seven of Nine, and that's it. But like, it's nice to have those characters, right? You don't have Crusher and Chekhov and all of that. So it's not like you've got all the main characters, but you still have, you know, these kind of nice sort of busts and then sort of dotted around my bookshelf. But like, if they cancel out the Enterprise D part work at 100 issues, you've got 2/3 of the Enterprise D. And like, that's not
what
a thing,
a
right? Yeah, like, like then you have nothing. So I it's sort of a little self-defeating in that regard, because then people like me who are like, well, maybe I would do it, but I would be worried it would never get to the end. I'm sort of contributing to helping it ensure that it won't get to the end by not signing up. But I don't know. It's just, that's a big investment. That is a massive model. I mean, you really have to have space for it, and I probably could find space for it, but I don't think I want it enough to like do that.
It's astonishing that I hadn't even thought about that. Is this I'm assuming this is a like reliable company that makes a lot of Star Trek stuff? And
oh sure, yeah, this is the company that does the ships that have been coming out for, you know, a number of years, and they've done pretty much every ship around. But like, you know, they started a graphic novel collection and they made it to 140 issues, and if they'd done 12 more issues, they would have reprinted every Star Trek comic ever published ever since the show came on air, including all the like really obscure like UK newspaper comic strips and stuff like that. But the economics didn't support doing the last 12 issues, so they ended it at 140, and you've got 90% of the comics that have ever been published, but you don't have the last 10%, and you just have to wonder, like, is it possible that something like that happens to this too?
Oh, wow. That is... God, that would be unbelievably frustrating. I can't even imagine. Oh, it is a bit of a self-defeating argument, right? You need enough people to buy into it to make it financially viable, but it's a leap of faith, right? You're trusting the...
Right.
Because they're not going to give you your money back if it doesn't go through. There's no contract that says they have to do it. So it is a little bit of a risk, I guess.
You have to think that they have thought about this, but, you know, when they have a plan and they figured out it is economically viable. And so, because, you know, you do burn yourself reputationally if you do that, because then the customers aren't going to come back for other stuff you want to do. So I have to think that it will almost certainly find a way of finishing itself out. But with the price and the uncertainty around it, and just the sheer sort of space needs associated with it, I'm just not sure it's a smart investment for me. That doesn't mean that it it's not for other fans. And if, hey, if you're interested, by all means, go ahead and sign up. This is not a way of trying to encourage people out of it. If you think it's cool and you have the space for it and you want to spend the money, go for it. It's just that for me, I'm not sure it's for me.
I completely agree. It's definitely cool. I'm not taking anything away from it. I mean, it looks spectacular. And if you're the kind of person that this appeals to, then by all means, go for it. I'm just having these mental images now of like an Enterprise that only has one nacelle because right. because the last one, you know, didn't get shipped out. Here's sort of a thought experiment. If you did sign up for this, are you the kind of person who every week when you got the next piece, I'm assuming each piece will connect to each other. I'm assuming that piece one connects to piece two, connects to piece three, connects to piece four. It would be weird if they were like, here's the first piece and then the next shipment, you got like the last piece.
Yeah, it's like a piece from a totally different part of the ship.
I'm assuming that it's all meant to go together one at a time. Are you the kind of person who would put it together each week as you got it? Ooh, now I'm going to put the next piece on. Or would you wait until you had all of the pieces, Lego style, and then do a big, like, a big build of the whole thing?
Probably somewhere in the middle where like I probably end up stacking up around like 10 to 15 issues and then just, you know, spending an hour and doing all of that and then stacking up another 10 to 15 and doing it that way. That's how I tend to be like for the ship magazines, you know, I'll rather than file them away each week, I'll just end up with a big stack of them and then periodically I'll sort of file them. Mm-hmm. I think that's more my style.
Well, I hope that it all works out and I hope that people enjoy it because, like I said, I think it looks great.
And lastly this week, we share the sad news that Herb Solo, an executive at Desilu Studios who helped shepherd the original Star Trek onto television, has died. He was 89. While at Desilu, Solo helped develop and then sell Star Trek to NBC, where it ran for 3 seasons. Solo is credited with inventing the Captain's Log and the Stardate, a staple for all Star Trek shows that followed, as well as convincing Gene Roddenberry to retain Spock's pointed ears. In later life, Solo wrote several well-regarded books about the original Star Trek, including Inside Star Trek, The Real Story, which covered the show's production history and was actually one of the first books to have done so. He is survived by his wife, 3 daughters, and a grandson. Our thoughts go out to his family.
I read Inside Star Trek, The Real Story. Have you ever read it?
I have it, and it's moved much quicker up to the top of my reading list. But no, I haven't actually read it yet.
It's really fascinating. I like behind-the-scenes books. So if you like that kind of stuff, I would highly recommend reading it. It's very interesting. You know, the 60s was kind of an interesting time in general in television production. And so he has lots of really good stories to tell. It's a really interesting book. And I liked that he says that he took credit for inventing the Stardate, which I think is just a great thing to be like, yeah, that was mine. I was the Stardate guy.
Yeah, the inventor of the Stardate.
If we tell everybody in advance, he calls it a flashback, which I think is really funny when you're talking about a science fiction show set in the future. But it's like, if we tell everybody up front that this is all a recording, then everybody knows everything's going to work out all right. And I was like, yeah. Great. What a great idea.
I buy it.
You know they're going to live long enough to record the Stardate at least.
Yeah, right.
So a sort of a weirdly unknown but influential TV icon. I didn't know he was also involved in Mission Impossible and Mannix. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that until I read his obituary today. So yeah, there's not much to say about him except great job on the Stardates and read his book, which is really interesting. And rest in peace.
All right. Well, we've talked about the facts. And now let's speculate on what's going to happen in the future of Star Trek.
You make some very good points, Captain. But it's still all speculation and theory.
So each week, I and my guest give you a wish or theory we're nurturing about any of the shows or the future of the franchise. So Matt, let's hear your theory or wish for this week.
All right, we're going to get into it now for a minute because last week I had if you had asked me this question last week, I would have given you a fairly involved theory involving Dr. Gillian Taylor and the probe from Star Trek IV.
Okay.
And how the probe and was going to be the source of the burn and that it was all going to relate back.
Yep.
And that the signal that they were receiving from the middle of whatever, the nebula or whatever, was going to be from the probe.
I like it.
Because there's a Star Trek novel that I think Christopher Bennett wrote back whenever, I don't know how old it was, but he wrote a novel that was all about the temporal investigation department or whatever they're called.
Yes.
That says that she was like their first like official case, right?
Yes, forgotten history.
He brings her to the future, and the temporal investigation unit is like, we have to put a stop to Kirk and his crazy time travel shenanigans.
Yes.
So I had this, to be fair, outlandish theory that it was all going to tie back into Star Trek IV, and that it would be an opportunity for a Catherine Hicks appearance in Star Trek Discovery, uh-huh. that she's been trapped out in this nebula with the probe. Because there was also this like book can talk to trance worms, which are kind of like whales in some way.
And yep.
maybe he's involved somehow. I had this, it all came from, I was probably high at the time, honestly, when I thought about it. But that was my theory last week. But I think this week's discovery with the Kelpians and the revelation that it's not that, that the signal is clearly something other than that, kind of blew that whole theory out of the water. So I wish you had asked me, I should have been on last week's episode. I would have had a really good answer. My answer this week is much less outlandish, but probably closer to the truth. I suspect that Giorgio is going to stay in the Mirror Universe at the end of next week's two-parter.
Uh-huh.
And that the Section 31 show is going to be set entirely in the Mirror Universe. And the Section 31 is going to be about her trying to convert the Terran Empire more into a Federation style. It's going to make Section 31 the good guys instead of having them be the creepy bad guys that they are.
Oh, interesting.
In the Prime Universe.
Yeah, that's an interesting theory. I mean, you know, we don't know what the Section 31 show is going to be about. I mean, we think we may be in the process of potentially watching the setup for that show, whatever it will end up being, because this week's episode does sort of very strongly give off the vibes that this is it for Empress Georgiou. Like, you know, you have all your classic TV farewells. You have the mysterious Carl helping Georgiou, you know, maybe go back in time. Maybe it's all a dream. Who knows? We'll find out next week.
I mean, it's the Guardian of Forever.
Yes, it is.
I mean, it's the Guardian of Forever.
Absolutely, the Guardian of Forever. And
let's stop pussyfooting around it. It's the Guardian of Forever.
It's not Q. It's the Guardian of Forever. And Bo Young Kim and Erica Lippold, they did not write the first part, but they do have a story credit. So I have to think this is tied into setup for the show. And that could be a really interesting way of doing it. That's certainly a very bold approach for a Star Trek show, would be to have it mostly set in this like deeply evil universe. But hey, I mean, if it's focused around this idea that you're trying to bring some good into that universe, then, you know, I think there's potentially something very noble and Star Trek-y about that.
This week's episode felt to me like setting up a backdoor pilot. You know, it's felt like they're clearly setting it up. This is Giorgio's like launching point that's going to launch her into whatever Section 31 ends up being. And the problem with the Section 31 show set in the Prime Universe has always been Section 31 is kind of creepy and evil. And
yeah, right.
Does anybody really want to watch a show about these people being creepy and evil? And you can argue that, well, they're anti-heroes and really they're just doing what has to be done and blah, blah, blah. But it still remains a question of whether or not somebody really wants to watch that show.
Right.
If you set it up where they're the good guys because they're in this evil universe, so they're like the underdogs fighting against the Terran Empire, that to me feels like a lot more interesting setup. I could be completely wrong, but I would watch that show.
I think I would watch that show too. Absolutely.
I mean let's be fair. We're going to watch any show that's called Star Trek. I mean, who are we kidding?
Okay, so my theory this week is a listener submission. This comes over Twitter from @JasonDawdy, whose theory is that the appearance of the Voyager J on Discovery earlier this season in the episode Die Trying will turn out not to just be a nice bit of fan service, but an early tease of the setting for Star Trek Prodigy. So he speculates, and I think I've talked a little bit about an idea like this on a previous episode as well, that obviously we know Kate Mulgrew is coming back to reprise the role of Janeway, but that does not necessarily mean that she is reprising the flesh and blood Captain Janeway or Admiral Janeway from, you know, the 2370s, 80s, 90s, etc. This could be a hologram or an artificial intelligence, you know, a representation of the person who was Janeway. So maybe this show is set aboard a 32nd century Voyager J, and it's it's a Janeway hologram who is the sort of mentor character to this group of lawless teens. And so that's his theory. And I think it's an interesting one. I mean, we've not had a confirmation of the time period. So it is certainly possible that Kate Mulgrew is playing Janeway, but maybe not in the way that we thought. I think I don't love that idea personally, because I think if I want to see Janeway again, I would like it to be the character and have any stakes be relevant to that character and not just sort of a simulacrum or a simulation or a facsimile of that character. But could be a really interesting approach for creating this kind of fun and new animated show. Matt, what do you think?
It did occur to me when I saw that after 900 years, they should probably be further along in the alphabet than J, just because ships get blown up a lot on Star Trek. So if the J stands for Janeway, that's kind of hilarious. Like
the Voyager Janeway AI.
Yeah, it's not because it's the 13th letter or whatever. It's because she's in charge. She's the body of the ship. She embodies the ship. I'd watch that.
I would watch that too. Do you have a theory or a wish for Discovery, Picard, Lower Decks, or the future of the franchise you'd like to share? Tweet them to me at Weekly Trek or email me at weeklytrek@thetricordertransmissions.com, and I might feature your theory in a future episode. Well, that's all the time we've got for this episode of Weekly Trek. Thank you so much to my guest, Matt McClendon, for joining me today. Matt, how can people contact you if they want to continue the conversation?
Well, they can. And listen to my podcast, which is called Warped, the Completely Unnecessary Podcast, where we do live audio commentary tracks, Mystery Science Theater style to, well, now we're into Star Trek The Next Generation episodes. We're about to finish season 2, but we started with the 60s series. So we're doing every show in order chronologically, so you can watch and listen along with us. You can find that on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts, WARPED. And you can follow the show on Twitter at Warped Trek, or you can follow me on Twitter at Host Warped.
And you can find this show on Twitter at Weekly Trek and me at Alexander T. Perry. And if you enjoy the show, please consider leaving us a 5-star review on your podcast player of choice. And please check out some of the other great shows on the Tricorder Transmissions. And if you like our shows, please also consider becoming a Patreon of Tricorder, which you can find at patreon.com/thetricordertransmissions. And lastly, if you're looking for Star Trek news on the internet, I hope you will turn to trekcore.com. Well, thank you, Matt. Thank you to all of my listeners, and until next week, live long and prosper.